These five design innovations have changed the games in Olympics forever. Today, we'll talk about a running shoe that was so fast that it was banned after first use. A swimsuit that helped Michael Phelps to win a record 8 gold medals in Beijing. A glove that stick to things like Spiderman. A bunch of composite materials that change the way we play most of the games. And finally, one category of product that is not exactly part of the game, but it is the most crucial and decide who wins the gold. Stick around till the end to find out. But before we dive deep into these design innovations, please consider subscribing and hit that subscribe button if you like to watch more content related to design and science behind the products. I really appreciate your support. So first, let's start with the running shoes that were banned from Olympics. These are Nike Vaporfly, a running shoe for long-distance track events like marathons and half marathons. The Nike Vaporfly first came into limelight in 2017. This was when Eliud Kipchoge, one of the world's top marathon runners, wore a prototype of Nike Vaporfly 4% during Nike's Breaking 2 project. The project aimed to break the 2-hour barrier for marathon distance. Although Kipchoge did not officially break the 2-hour mark, he finished in 2 minutes and 25 seconds, but his performance brought significant attention to the shoes due to their innovative design and performance benefits. In 2016 Olympic marathon, the top 3 were wearing these shoes, and the Olympic committee became a bit skeptical about these shoes and banned them from future use, saying that it gives the runner an unfair advantage. They called it mechanical doping. Let's see how it works. In every running shoe, you have an upper part which holds your foot, the outsole which touches the ground and provides traction, and one midsole that helps in returning some of the applied energy back with the bounce for the next step. The upper layer of Nike Vaporfly is designed with lightweight, breathable material called Flyknit and Vaporwave. Flyknit is a knitted textile that provides a sock-like fit, offering both support and flexibility. Vaporweave, on the other hand, is an ultra-light, water-resistant fabric that reduces water absorption and keeps the shoes lightweight even in wet condition. Both materials enhance breathability and reduce the overall weight of the shoe, which is very crucial for long-distance running. In the midsole, Nike uses ZoomX foam, a proprietary midsole foam known for its exceptional energy return and cushioning. ZoomX foam is made from Pebex, a lightweight and responsive material that compresses and rebounds with each step, providing both comfort and propulsion. Embedded within a ZoomX is a full-length carbon plate, which acts like a spring, bending and snapping back into place with each stride, which propels the runner forward and improves the running efficiency. The combination of ZoomX foam and the carbon fiber plate results in improved running economy, reduced fatigue, and enhanced speed. And the outsole is designed to provide traction, durability, and stability. It features rubber pods strategically placed in high wear areas to enhance grip and durability on various surfaces from wet roads to tracks. The patent tread on the outsole is optimized to maintain grip while minimizing the weight. And that's how Vaporfly started the whole new category of shoes, which are called super shoes. Next, let's go deep into water with Speedo LZR Racer suit. Introduced in 2008, this suit was a game changer. Famously worn by Michael Phelps during his historic 8 gold medal performance at the Beijing Olympics. Let's explore how this suit came to life and why it was eventually banned. The Speedo LZR Racer suit was developed in collaboration with NASA. NASA helped them to analyze the drag on different fabrics using the same techniques they used to test spacecraft materials. Drag is the force that slows you down during swimming, and you have to apply more of your body's energy to overcome it. If you want to swim faster, you have to reduce it as much as possible. NASA used wind tunnels and computational fluid dynamics to identify the optimal fabric and design for reducing drag in water, and that fabric was called LZR Pulse, which was lightweight and water repellent. This fabric is designed to reduce the drag, compresses the swimmer body, and improve buoyancy. So when the drag is low, there is less resistance, and when the suit is compressed on your body, it's like a second skin which supports the muscle group to give more output. And buoyancy helps you to stay afloat more easily. For another suit's standout feature is this ultrasonically welded seams, which create a perfectly smooth surface by eliminating traditional stitched seams that can create additional drag. But Michael Phelps was not the only one who benefited from it. In total, swimmers wearing the LZR Racer suit broke 23 world records during the 2008 Olympics, which shows you the effectiveness of this suit. But it also sparked debates about the role of technology in sports. In response to these concerns, the International Swimming Federation implemented new regulations in 2010, banning the use of full-body suits like the LZR Racer suits in competition. Despite its ban, the legacy of Speedo LZR Racer suit lives on. From the pool, let's move to a critical component for many sports, the gloves. The introduction of gloves in various Olympic sports generally happened over time. All the games like boxing, gymnastics, football, cycling, rowing, fencing were played bare hands, but at one point or another in the 20th century, gloves were introduced in all of these games. Any glove should have two basic features. First, it should be sticky enough to provide a good grip on the equipment, and second, it should be ergonomic enough that you don't lose control due to the extra layer between your hands and the equipment. To enhance grip and control, gloves are designed with materials like silicon and rubberized coating. Like Adidas has created their proprietary material called Grip Tech, which enhances grip in both wet and dry conditions and commonly used in ball games like football to catch the ball like a lizard catches a fly. Now, the level of grip required from gloves varies significantly depending on the sport. For activities involving equipment like bats or handles, such as baseball or tennis, a very high grip is essential to ensure that the equipment remains securely in athlete's hand. So the glove material should prevent slippage and provide a firm hold. On the other hand, sports that involve gripping bars or sticks, such as gymnastics or pole vaulting, require a different approach. In these cases, the gloves must offer a secure grip but should also allow for a clean release when necessary. Therefore, the materials are selected to provide effective traction without causing the gloves to stick excessively. Now, only grip strength is not enough. A glove should be ergonomic so that it enhances rather than hinders the athlete's performance. To achieve this, gloves also have breathable fabric, strategically placed at various points and areas of the hand that will be most active during that sport. For example, around the fingers and joints to allow for natural movement and reduce discomfort. This way, the gloves provide the necessary grip without sacrificing control or comfort, helping athletes perform at their best. Next, let's see how composite materials have changed the Olympic Games. Imagine trying to run in a marathon in heavy hiking boots. Ridiculous, right? Now think of athletes competing in the Olympics with old-school wooden tennis rackets or steel bicycles. Thankfully, the sporting world has moved beyond the Stone Age, thanks to the miracle of composite materials. These wonder materials have not only transformed how sport equipment is made, but have also revolutionized how athletes perform. But why we need composite materials? Picture this. You are a gymnast and you are about to perform on the uneven bars. You grip the bar and suddenly it snaps. The wooden bar breaks in half. Not exactly the gold medal movement you were aiming for. Traditional materials like wood, metal, and leather were solid for their time, but had serious limitations. They were heavy, prone to breaking, and not exactly designed for peak performance. Enter composite materials, the superheroes of the sporting world, saving athletes from subpar gear and helping them to achieve their best performance. Let's look at some of the examples of composite materials in Olympic sports. Cycling. Carbon fiber frames make bikes so light and aerodynamic, it's almost like they come with inbuilt rocket boosters. For rowing, composite oars that slice through water faster than the hot knife through butter. For tennis, rackets made from graphite composites offer power and control, making every match feel like a grand slam. For pole vaulting, carbon fiber poles that are as strong as Superman, letting athletes soar to new heights. For protective gear, helmets and body armor that makes athletes feel like superheroes. In a nutshell, materials are the unsung heroes of the Olympics. They have turned clunky, unreliable gear into state-of-the-art equipment that's lighter, stronger, and perfectly tailored for each sport. So next time you watch the Olympics, remember, it's not just the athletes breaking records, but also the amazing materials that help them reach new heights. And the final category of products that decide who wins the gold are Omega timekeeping devices. Since 1932, Omega has been the unsung hero of Olympic Games, ensuring that every race, jump, and flip is timed with precision, because even a fraction of a second can turn a bronze into a gold. Let's see how Omega's timekeeping methods impacted different Olympic events. So for track and field events, two things are important: the start and the finish. They need to time the start so no one starts early or have a false start. And of course, they have to time the finish to decide who wins the gold medal. So for the start, Omega uses the starting blocks with built-in sensors, measures an athlete's force against the footrest 4,000 times per second. The detection system instantly sends the force measurement to an on-site computer so that starter can visually see any false start. The rules of the World Athletics fix the minimum reaction time at 100 milliseconds. Any reaction which takes place below the limit considered to be a premature and places the runners in false start situation. Another device is starting pistol. The problem with a traditional pistol is that sound travels slower than light, meaning the athletes in the furthest lanes would hear the start later than everyone else, while closer athletes will hear it first. Today, Omega's solution is an electronic pistol that is connected to a speaker positioned behind each racer. So when the trigger is pressed, a sound is played, a light flash is emitted, and a start pulse is given to the timing device. This system is the fairest way to give every athlete an equal start. And for the finish, remember the traditional tape that was stretched across the finish line? Since 1948, this has been replaced by photocell technology, which emits beams of light instead. As soon as the winning athlete crosses those beams, their winning time is instantly recorded. Omega now uses four photocells on the finish line, all integrated into one unit, allowing more body patterns to be detected. While this gives Omega an immediate finishing time, the official time is always taken from the photo finish camera, which can capture up to 40,000 digital images per second. This makes it faster for judges to decide the result and separate close finishes with maximum clarity. For swimming, they use Omega touch pads. At the end of swimming race, the famous touch pads positioned at both ends of the pool allow swimmers to stop the clock by exerting a pressure of between 1.5 kg and 2.5 kg. Because of these touch pads, swimming has long been the only sport in which competitors can stop their own running time. And to declare the winner in swimming, they used an innovative light system called the Swimming Light Show. It features lights mounted on the starting blocks at the end of the pool. When the race is over, a single large dot indicates the athletes that came first, two medium-sized dots to show who came second, and three smaller dots of light confirm the third place finisher. It's a perfect way for athletes and spectators to instantly see the outcome of a race. And to time all the other games, they don't use a mechanical stopwatch. They use an Omega quantum timer, which has enhanced resolution of 1/1,000,000th of a second, driven by microcrystal component embedded in the timer. The resolution is 100 times greater than previous devices and with a maximum variation of only 1 second out of every 10 million seconds. It is 5 times more accurate. Omega's role as the official timekeeper of the Olympic Games is crucial for the drama, excitement, and fairness of the competition. These 5 innovations are just a few examples of how product design and technology continue to push the boundaries of what's possible in sports. From the shoes on their feet to timekeeping system that record their victories. These advancements not only enhance performance, but also ensure fairness and inclusivity in the Olympics. That's it for today. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit the bell icon for more insights into the science of products. See you next time. Thank you.